Hi, this is Chinmayee. I have not stepped into Instagram Live in a very long time, and I just thought it is good to say hello and speak about something that I have been sharing on my socials for a couple of days now. This is basically about the sexual grooming by these two men, one Mr. Ruben and the other Mr. Sam Jaisundar of Scripture Union. It looks like they have gone to a lot of schools in South India, spreading the word of their God and thereby winning the trust of a lot of parents. They were soft-spoken, they were well-behaved, they were gentlemen. And their modus operandi was to ask minors, young children between the age of 11, 10 to 14, asking them for photographs, saying, "I saw you in sports day and your dress was drenched." And some of these kids have actually gone and told other women members who are a part of the group. And the women have asked these children to shut up and not make a big deal out of it because their careers would be ruined. Especially since 2018, after being a survivor myself, one of the things that I would like to remind you is that when I outed my story about Mr. Vairamuthu in 2018, October, I was promptly banned by BJP's Mr. Radha Ravi. At that point in time, the DMK supporters, all of Mr. Vairamuthu's supporters across Malaysia, Singapore, Tamil Nadu, and Sri Lanka, a lot of Sri Lankan Tamils were very angry because they believed that Mr. Vairamuthu is their poster boy who is saving Tamil or whatever it is. And they would not believe me. And they called me a BJP stooge because of my caste and religious identity. They said I was taking revenge on Mr. Vairamuthu, and they politicized it. End of the day, I got banned by BJP's Mr. Radha Ravi. It's been 2 years. I have sung a sum total of about 5 or 6 songs in Tamil, while just about in 2018 in October, I had the biggest hit of my career in 96. I had dubbed and I had sung all the songs. I was literally at the peak of my career, and I remember my mother literally begging me not to out Mr. Vairamuthu and just stop myself from sharing my own story and just end it with sharing other people's stories. But I did not feel it was the right thing to do, and I did not feel honest doing it. Thankfully, I had a very, very supportive family. My husband and in-laws stood 100% behind me, because a lot of people will, you know, constantly threaten a married woman, saying your husband will leave you, what about your in-laws, what about your family, what about your future. And then that is when I realized that this particular advantage that I have is something that girls don't have with their own parents. My mother, of course, she came from a place of fear. She's a divorcee and she's always faced the raw end of the stick as long as society is concerned. So I understand that. But I was in a more confident place. I felt safer with a very safe partner. Now, if you see the Hathras case, the Hathras gang rape case. Now, suddenly they are saying there was no rape. MLAs and MPs are coming on and saying multiple reports, medical reports are saying, yes, there was rape. Yes, there was penile penetration. Yes, there was tears in the private parts of the vagina. But there was no rape. But this, but that, but this. See, what happens when survivors come out with a story and people make it about one party versus the other, one caste versus the other, one religion versus the other, or one of the first things that all of us are used to is, oh my God, it is fake, where is your evidence? Now, the first thing that all of us, I think we have been trying to repeat over the past 2 years, is that even if it is domestic violence, domestic abuse, or even if it is sexual harassment, it happens between two people. And more often than not, there is no evidence to it. That is the nature of the crime. So to find evidence, to corroborate the evidence, to find or to prove the accused guilty or innocent is the cop's job. It is not the survivor's job. So I usually find a lot of supporters of Mr. Vairamuthu asking me, what happened to your case? What happened to your case? I mean, that is precisely the same thing that I am also asking. 2018 end or something, I had sent an email to NCW, and they had sent 4 reminders to the DGP of Tamil Nadu saying, please follow up on this case. But what happens when you speak up about a very politically powerful man like Vairamuthu, who's also backed by other people, and they will do everything that they can to stifle my voice. And of course, you would also know that, right? You know, at that point in time, I think Mr. Radha Ravi was with the DMK, and then he promptly banned me, and then he was hired by the BJP, and he's now in some sort of an executive committee. He, Mr. Radha Ravi, was actually kicked out of the DMK because he abused a woman on stage in a public event. But this is the kind of guy that the BJP hired. So if you see, one of the things that we all women and men who care for women's safety need to understand is that none of the political parties by default actually care for women's safety. It is a byline. It is a line that everybody says. BJP may say Beti Bachao today. In 2012, nobody really cared when the BJP politicized the gang rape of Nirbhaya. There was the slogan which says Khoob Hua Nari Parwar Ab Ki Bar Modi Sarkar. It's still there. I mean, if you probably search for these words, you'll find that slogan. It basically translates to enough of these assaults on women, let us choose Modi Sarkar at this point. So in 2012, I was one of those vociferous voices, very angry voices, which was talking about the brutality of the gang rape on Nirbhaya in 2012. And I was one of those voices who criticized the former PM Manmohan Singh after he said "theek hai" on that video that he addressed the nation. I criticized the Congress. I said, where is the safety for the women? What are you going to change? But from there to now, a lot of people will say, you're constantly targeting UP. The maximum number of rape cases are actually in Kerala. So if you're not a leftist liberando, whatever, blah, 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 then speak about Kerala. Okay, so this is, as much as people think that, you know, people at this point are targeting one state, overall for women, we are all losing. We are not safe. We are not. Every day, every government, every politician comes and goes. All of them keep bickering and fighting, and there are things that happen in front of the camera. Journalists who put their work online, their life online, and they get abused. Some of them get beaten by other people. It is a ruckus. But if you see, at the end of the day, 6 years later, 8 years later, are women any safer? Are children any safer from trafficking, from abuse, from molestation, from harassment, from rape and from kidnapping? No. You see that the crimes, that the rate of crimes have actually steadily, they have risen. In a way, you could probably look at it in a different way and say it's a good thing that there is confidence in society now to actually report rapes and report sexual assault and harassment. If you take the Sam Jayasundar and Rubens case, there are so many minors, so many children out there who are extremely scared of telling this to their parents because these men have instilled a lot of confidence in their families and they are the men of God. And I think that is the one thing that I need to say. Anybody who comes across as a man of God, God man, Swamiji, you know, this sort of a person who comes across as this, what I would call as a middleman to God, right? Whoever it might be. If you believe that you need therapy, speak to a psychologist, speak to a psychiatrist, speak to somebody with science, a science background who can help you with whatever your issues are. The concept of black magic, tantra, somebody has done something to me. All of this is stuff that people can keep, you know, putting these fears into you and you'll keep going back to them. And when you're at your most emotionally vulnerable, you'll be caught in this endless loop of trying to fight unknown enemies. Then when this becomes really bad, then this manifests as delusional disorders and schizophrenia. Maybe I shouldn't even be saying stuff like that, but the level and the extent of imaginations really goes to a very different level in a lot of people. So if you believe in a Swamiji or a Godman, or if you're learning meditation, you're learning yoga, or you're learning any sort of a spiritual practice, whatever your faith might be, please keep it to that. Don't let them rule your life. Have your own brains. Learn that every faith, every God, every, in my opinion at least, I think all paths lead to the same enlightenment, and after one is dead, after this body is gone, you'll be a part of the soil in some way or the other. Either you'll be ashes or you'll become decomposed soil and food for worms. it's what happens next, this concept of hell and hellfire, hell and heaven, all of this is very, it's stuff that none of us know about. So while you're alive, try and be just, try and be honest, try and be truthful, and try and speak up for, I wouldn't say try, please do this, please do and speak up for the, for those whose voices have been taken away from them. I will not say, I learned this the hard way, it's not the voice of, you know, the voiceless, they have their voice but they are not being heard. So when you have privilege, make sure that your privilege and your power is used to empower other people. When survivors come out and speak, let it not be that the first thing that you say is, where is the proof? You are unnecessarily assassinating somebody's character. 99% of women, and I would say children, really don't want to come and talk about some uncle who treated them badly. They really don't have agendas. They don't have stuff to say that this uncle molested me or this uncle sent me these messages. And a lot of them also delete these messages out of fear that their parents will find out and then the children themselves will get beaten up. So one of the things that you need to do as a parent, if you're a parent or if you're an adult with a child around you, please be wary of which adults, who they are talking to. It's been 2 years and counting. I'm still saying that people don't talk to and listen to their own children when they are saying that they're getting molested or misbehaved with by somebody in their own family and friend circle. 94 to 96% of the time, the assaulter is known to the victim/survivor. So you need to understand that the more you deny, the more you try to ignore, the more you try to silence these voices, at some given point in time, there'll be another Me Too movement where there'll be a lot more anger, there'll be a lot more hate, and then your children will end up hating you as they grow up. If you don't want this to happen, and if you want to instill trust, if you want to be there for your children and your children to be there for you, it is a give and take. You don't own your children. Your children came through you. You were a vessel through which your children came into this world. You chose to have those children and you don't own them. You cannot control them and you cannot say that, you know, I gave birth to you and hence you need to do this. And I think at least in 2020, it is time that we started talking about caste, especially our upper class, upper caste, privileged people need to start talking about caste, talking about our privileges and see how and when we can take a step back, stop shitting and dissing on reservation. As an upper caste woman myself, I know so many of my friends, my circle constantly kept saying that upper caste savarnas are actually the ones who are in danger. And then when you actually see ground reality, you are not being denied water, you are not being thrown stuff at you, you are not being forced to collect garbage because your ancestors were doing it, you are not forced to clean toilets and not be paid for it because you are expected to not get paid for it and apparently it is your caste identity. Now if you see, I think a lot of people in the Valmiki caste have stopped showing up for work in the sanitation because I think it's their way of showing solidarity to the victim. Whatever said and done, whether Kerala has the highest rate of rapes or whether Uttar Pradesh has the highest rate of domestic violence, it's all there in the NCRB data. Whether Uttar Pradesh has a higher population and hence you need to look at the percentage vis-a-vis Kerala, which has a lower population and the rates of crimes are higher. All of these data's numbers, even if it is one rape, even if it is one case, and if the state machinery and the police could actually find it in them to burn the body of a victim without letting the family be there in the dead of the night by absolute strangers, I think that way Uttar Pradesh has gone down in history by being the only state in India, I hope, to have the police burn the victim's body. And now they can come up with a lot of theories and say that the body didn't have this, the body didn't have that. Of course, there is no body to conduct a proper forensic report anyway. So people can keep speculating and stories can keep happening and then we can continue doubting ourselves. I mean, whom do we trust, whom do we not trust? But at the end of the day, there is always this niggling doubt in me that at the end of the day, the women lose. We don't get justice. 2 years on, we see the MJ Akbars, being at the most influential places. Ramesh Prabha, who has actually molested children, be on debates on popular channels. You will see Mr. Vairamuthu hanging out with all the major stars in Tamil Nadu. Mr. Radha Ravi in the BJP. And you will see people, all these supporters of all these political parties, turn a complete blind eye when a man from their own party is named. Ask a lot of these BJP supporters about Radha Ravi. I'm talking about the absolute absolute blinded ones, okay? I'm not saying that everybody does this, but ask them about Mr. Radha Ravi, they'll be absolutely silent. They will, you won't even wonder, and you have to ask them, why the heck do you allow somebody like this to be there? He's openly abusive. I mean, he is not respectful to women, is recorded on every stage that he speaks on. So, I mean, why do you remain silent? But they remain silent because the party needs to toe a line, and there is a party whip, and the party stand is everybody's stand. So all of this stuff is the problem in Indian governance. Today, the women in BJP are unable to speak about the Hathras victim, even if they feel for it, because the party stand is something else. And who's the party? It's still the men. So even if you think that there are women in positions of power, they actually don't have real power when it comes to I think ground reality. Similarly, if you saw, there was this other guy, I think there's this the case of minor girls, I think, who were kidnapped and raped in Balrampur, Rajasthan, I think, because as soon as UP was coming up, they said, speak about Balrampur, speak about this also, otherwise you're not a neutral person, you are biased. So I said, this is not a fight against the states. We are talking about one victim here, and it's not as if we don't care about the others. We are asking you, why as men, why as society, why haven't we done more to create a safer space? And the point is, why don't we all hold our elected representatives responsible? There is a Nirbhaya Act, there is a fund, there is money, there was supposed to have been cameras out there. And there is one thing that all upper caste people need to understand, that oppressed caste women go through two levels of oppression. One because of their gender and one because of their caste identity. The men might be called untouchable or anything like that, but the women are expected to be available for rape for a lot of these upper caste powerful men. And this is something that all upper caste women, feminists, men, all of them need to understand, that it is not the same. You cannot say, why bring caste into this? Because if a crime has happened because of caste identity, then you mention it has happened because of caste identity. And you speak about it, because that awareness is required. Don't question journalists, why are you bringing caste? If again, if somebody has been hacked or somebody has been murdered because they didn't convert to another faith or religion, then yes, in that case also, whoever is the oppressed, then you need to stand with the oppressed there also. It's not as if, it's pretty sad that time and again, people like me have to keep proving to people that we are not biased and we actually speak for everybody. But at the same point, the number of cases, the number of crimes against women every day, it is exhausting as a woman. Every day you read something like this, you are tired, you are exhausted, you are wondering, where is the Gadi Moksham, and where are you going to be able to bring the next generation into this world, wondering, is this going to be a safer place? Because sexual, and how many ever times you tell men in society, the majority of the men in society, the speed at which they come to women and say your case and allegation and everything is fake, and when we turn back and say, what have you done as a man to question sexism, question patriarchy, or the locker room jokes, how have you made it safer between your own boy gang for all of us, not just for girls? But it took feminists to speak about safety for the boy child to men, because young boys are also being raped and molested and sodomized and gang raped by older men. So who's going to be speaking about these laws? Feminists. At that point in time, feminists are nice people, otherwise they are bad people. All that we can do is fake allegations so I'm not saying that all allegations and all accusations will be 100% true. A crime of this nature is very difficult to prove. Whether it is India, whether it is the US, it is very, very difficult to prove. I'm not saying it is easy. It is the accused's word against the accused, accuser's word against the accused. And all of this corroboration, speaking to other witnesses, all of this and collecting evidence is the police's job, right? So the point is, too, when women like me speak about a safer space, when we say believe the victim, we mean believe the victim so that they can speak up without fear. They can speak up and say that this happened to me. create a safe space that they are not threatened into silence. And that happens when you basically believe the victim. Imagine you have a child and the child comes and tells you, you can even be a teacher, or this could be a neighbor's child that you like so much, or your sister's friend who's playing in your house, and that child comes and says, this uncle is touching me. So are you going to tell the child that you're lying? Or are you going to tell your best friend from school that some uncle that you both know, or maybe even if you're a guy and some aunt that you both know had touched their genitals, and then are you going to say that just because it's your best friend, you're going to say that, you know, and you both know this person who's the accused, are you going to tell your best friend that, you know, you're a liar? You don't do that. So you listen to them, you create a safe space. When we create a safe space, we create a safe space for them to be heard without judgment and shaming and any sort of more trauma, because the trauma of going through sexual harassment itself is pretty high. Then you cannot make it more traumatizing for a survivor of sexual harassment or abuse. Especially, it is even worse for men. Men have no chance in this society, in this patriarchal, toxic, masculine society, to come and tell their own male friends that they were molested. They actually end up confiding in women. They don't confide in other male friends, because they'll say, enna nee omboda. These are the kind of words that Tamil men use. They call them other words. They call them, are you gay? So these are, they don't understand that these crimes also happen. And again, please understand, I'm not saying about all men. Don't come and tell me about not all men. I also not all men, okay? So the point here is that creating a safe space for survivors means that believing the victim, creating a system where our accusations are taken to the logical end. I have filed a case 2 years. There's not even one investigation. Everybody is dancing around with Mr. Vairamuthu and Mr. Radha Ravi, and nobody even knows what the heck. And I'm the only lone voice left asking what happened, what happened, what happened. And then after a point, I'm going to get tired, because I know this is how the Indian justice system, and everybody else without a conscience will talk about, as soon as they want to be politicians, they'll talk about women's safety. But when it actually comes to doing something to do something about women's safety, they would not have done anything, because in their own backyard there are a lot of skeletons. So this is exactly what you need to do. When a survivor speaks, listen, do not criticize, do not shame them, do not call their allegations fake. Whether the allegations are fake or not is to be decided by the police. Make it a safe space. And the police stations have to be a safe space for survivors to go and lodge their complaint. Courts are definitely need to be a safer space for children and for adults to actually do this, because the other side lawyer, I know how Mr. Radha Ravi's lawyer speaks to me in court. He assassinates my character. So all of this stuff you need to be ready for, and I would say be prepared for it. Do it anyway. File the case anyway, because the other side lawyer is paid to defend his molester or his rapist. That's going to happen. Even an Ajmal Kasab in this country, who bombed our country and the terminus and our parliament, had a representation. That is the law of this country, because it wants to be just even to the criminal. So you can't say, how can he have a lawyer? How can he speak like this? That guy is paid to do that. So the point is, the next thing that people will say, what will happen to my daughter if she will not get married? The only fact is, if you have a partner who's not going to marry you, if you are going to have in-laws who's not going to marry you just because you were groped or molested or assaulted, and you actually took the time and effort to hire a lawyer and go to court and go to file a complaint and get this done in the logical way, if they have a problem with that, you shouldn't marry a person like that. Please run for your life. You don't need such partners, neither do you need such families who are so toxic that they don't even understand that something like this needs to be cleansed and culled. This collective silence from society, this collective silence, like, oh my God, what happens to the man's career? It's okay. A lot of our careers have gone to the dust. A lot of women have lost their career, lost their entire dreams, lost their ambitions, given away their dreams. They have learned music, they have quit on music just because they never wanted to be molested by another man in the industry again. For example, whichever industry that might be. The bigger thing that we keep talking about, once come December season, you'll find all the molesters who were named in the Carnatic Me Too, be on stage again, and all the mamas and mamis will say, Abba, enna ma padrel, and all of that, completely forgetting that some child got molested by these men, and they will completely forget, because again, regardless of caste, religion, political ideology, I have seen one thing: the majority of people and this is coming from personal opinion, personal experience. So if you want to take it with a bag of salt, please take it. But I speak my experience, so that is true. So regardless of caste, religion, political identity, a lot of these people tend to defend molesters who belong to any of this that they belong to. So I have seen Brahmins aggressively defend molesters in the Carnatic music community. I have seen other people, you know, the DMK supporters and Vairamuthu supporters aggressively defend Vairamuthu. Earlier, those who actually questioned Mr. Radha Ravi ended up supporting him now because he is in the BJP. So I have seen people just change like that and be chameleons, and which is why I ask, women need to be the decision makers. At least the next time that we have to vote, please do make your own decisions. Vote for the party which does not have a rapist or a molester in it, number one. And two, somehow look for all of this, look for all these politicians, look for which politician speaks in which way. Because I think a couple of days ago, even a politician associated with the Congress called the Balrampur incident a very small incident considered, you know, in comparison to the Hathras case. So politicians will always find some shitty thing to say about women and assaults on women, because ultimately we are not their vote bank, right? So what do we do to become the vote bank? We'll have to somehow take the decisions in our hands and not vote for some party just because our grandmother and grandfather voted for something or our husband is voting for something. Make your own decisions. Women are very discerning in a lot of things. Make your decisions. Stand for survivors. Believe survivors enough to give them a safe space to lodge their complaints so that they can take it to the logical conclusions. Police stations and courts are still not safe for a lot of survivors to go through and actually file their cases, because nobody knows how the law works. And especially coming back to this Scripture Union case of Mr. Sam and Mr. Rubin and the women who have supported him. Please, if survivors can come together, this is a POXO case, this is a prevention of child sexual abuse case. So you can actually, according to Indian law, even if you're an adult now, even if this happened several years ago, they will take cognizance. Please, all of you get together. If some of you are talking to some of these survivors, somehow convince them and their families, file a collective joint case, write to the NCW, to Rekha Sharma, and she will receive the email and she will let the right police stations know. If, especially in these cases, when the numbers seem to run into dozens and dozens and dozens of kids, and so far only girls have spoken up. I don't know if there have been survivors and boys. I don't know if there is, because a pedophile is a pedophile. He's going to go after any child, in my opinion. Gender doesn't matter. But this, as long as this Sam and Ruben case is concerned, please do the needful. A POXO case is a strong case. When 10 children, 15 children, or even 5 children come forward and say that this man has done this to me, and if you can show those chats, it's very easy for police to find out if the chats are fake or not. So don't worry about it. I've seen some cooked up conversations saying this entire thing was fake just to protect those guys. Apparently it was created in an app called Funsta, and all this stuff happens because I've gone through this. They'll create fake conversations to try and bring down somebody who's speaking up for survivors, because that's how the power structures work. I have experienced this myself. They'll want to call us liars, they'll want to call us, oh, we are biased, oh, we are not speaking the truth, or they'll call us, you're against minority religions. So all of this will happen. But the point is, the only question that I'm going to leave you with, as a society, as politicians come and politicians go, as governments come and governments go, they are not going to change. They are made in a certain way. Their mental makeup and their wiring is very different. But how are we as a society making it safer for our children? How are we as a society making it safer for women to walk around without the fear of sexual assault and harassment and abuse and assault? What are we doing to not police and control and shame and abuse women in public spaces? I mean, look at even how politicians refer to female politicians from one party to another. So even politicians, even if they are females, they are not spared. Overall, there might be a lot of people who are angry who will say that feminism is not required. But I would say feminism is required even more now. The gender ratio is really bad in this country right now. We have far fewer women to men ratio. There is a big problem staring at us in our faces. And more, female feticide has not come down really in a lot of places. Girls and girl babies are getting killed. There is a lot of awareness that we need to be talking about in multiple things. And in a way, social media has democratized a lot of things. Yes, maybe there will be people like me who step into something and do something for the first time, and we end up, you know, because we are the first, and we end up being, you know, losing some things. And I'm not unhappy because of that. I'm grateful for whatever I did, and I really, really hope that in the future, let's say, we will be in a place, say 5 to 7 years down the line, as a society, we'll have to grow a conscience and to make this place a safe space for all genders and for all human beings to live their most authentic and their happiest selves. Least we can do as a society, don't you think?